Well, I want to thank you, and I want to thank everybody. And I also want to thank Steve Shore, who got me into this really at the very beginning. So I've actually been at every single conference. So that's fun. Today, we're going to do something, start a little differently. The essence of really what we're doing with our food is to eat in a way that makes everything sacred and to activate spiritual joy. So I'm going to do a little dancing for people, but I'm asking everybody also to get up and dance. We'll dance for about 3 minutes. First, I'm going to do a prayer, which is about merging the heavens and the earth, the heart and the mind, which is really missing in our society and in our lives. So this is the focus. So here's the prayer. Ishenikud kudashar brihu ushinite bi'ilo arimulayhaj yuke bubavke biyuda shlom b'shem kozriel kolam. Amen. But just feel the merging of your heart and mind. So we begin operating from what I call chokmah halev, the wisdom of the heart. Just feel that for a moment. Okay, now we are going to do a little dancing, inviting all of you, because dancing is a way of really experiencing spiritual joy. Before we get there, I'm just going to mention, now many of you probably have your own meditation, but this is a meditation that was given to me after a 21-day water fast when I was living in the United States. And it's yod on the in-breath, hey, on the out-breath. Wah on the in-breath. Hey, on the out-breath. Yod from the base to the heart. Hey, out through the heart. Wah from the base to the third eye. And then again, hey, out to the heart. You just simply keep repeating it to your mind's quiet. So we're going to dance for 3 minutes. Then we'll meditate for 3 minutes. And then we'll get into the talk, which is really about spiritual nutrition and spiritual nutrition and veganism. So with that, I'm going to just get ready to dance a little bit with you. And kind of get in my Superman outfit here. Here we go. 1 second more. Okay. Okay, so let's all dance together, okay? Here we go. Not quite hearing the music. Turn the music on. Okay. Just take a second. Get myself here. So we're going to go into meditation, and the energy is going to go through my eyes into you to awaken that, the spiritual energy. Okay. 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 So just let the energy go through. It just be 3 minutes. And just feel that activation of the energy to help awaken your spiritual energy. Okay, so 3 minutes now, meditating. Yod on the in-breath, hey on the out-breath. Yod on the in-breath. Okay, slowly we come out of meditation. And often we do a little bit of sharing to check on your experience. And I think in this context, unless there's something technically we can do, we should save it for the questions at the end. I think that would be best. So we're going to just start with the slideshow. Okay. And I'll tell you my story a little bit. I really was not really raised a vegan. I was pretty much a meat-eating football player. Okay. And in 1975, I met Swami Muktananda, and I had a very deep meditation. I went way up into the nothing. There we go, we got it. And a little voice, still silent voice of God rang out. And it said, you should learn to eat in a way that can awaken the kundalini or spiritual, kundalini is what it said, or spiritual energy. In Kabbalistic, we call it the Ruach Kodesh, or sacred feminine. You should learn to eat that way. That was 75. So over a period of 7 years, I transitioned to a 99% live food vegan diet. That's how it happened. It was kind of funny. We also, in 1973, my wife and I had a nightmare dream. She was pregnant. The dream is that we were eating the fetus. And it was like, oh. And that day we became vegetarian, both of us. So kind of somewhere along the line, there was a big push to become vegetarian, vegan, and ultimately live food, which is pretty much my diet today. Now, the key to this diet is it has to be done to your constitution. Some people need 30% protein, other people need 70% protein in their diet. There's a variation. So I get about 99% success rate because I develop according to people's constitution. I figure out what the constitution is. There's a little questionnaire. I have my website. You can go to drcousens.com or treeoflife.mn.co, and you can get a questionnaire, fast, slow oxidizer. So I kind of learned, and what I saw over time is instead of getting weaker, as some people complain, I got stronger. So this is 50 years ago, and at that point, I could do a certain amount, 70, 80 push-ups. Now, today and the last week, I've been doing approximately 2,000 push-ups at one time. What am I saying? You get stronger with over time, regardless of age. So my age right now, 79 cycles around the planet. It's like you get stronger, you get more flexible, you get more energy. This is partly a result, obviously, of a positive mindset, but clearly a live food vegan diet plays a big role. So maybe 3 times a week, I'm doing my 2,000 push-ups and my 900 sit-ups, and it's really an easy flow. So that's where it can go. What am I saying? We can get, with age, we can get stronger, more flexible, and have more energy. Think about that, because it's really a paradigm shift. And so that's why I'm sharing it, really, not to brag. It's like, this is a paradigm shift. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so that's me. Holistic, liberated, vegan from Eden. The main thing is you're having a good time. That's that spiritual joy that I'm talking about. That's why dancing is so important. Spiritual joy makes everything kind of out there being unimportant. And you can focus on that, and then we can deal with the world. And of course, there's lots of things happening in the world that, you know, for the moment don't look so good. Next slide, please. So this is the key. When health is absent, wisdom cannot reveal itself. Think about that. That's what we're talking about. Art can't manifest. Strength can't fight. Wealth becomes useless, and intelligence can't be applied. So we are talking about a holistic health paradigm that involves wisdom and art and strength and intelligence as a total way of living in the world. Diet playing a very important part of that. Next slide, please. And that's me at 79. That's what we're talking about now. And again, flexibility, sitting in full lotus. You know, you just saw me dance. This is not an accident. It's something you build over time. And it does work if you apply it correctly. That's the good news that I'm really sharing in today's talk. Next slide. And it also enhances relationship because you have more energy to be present in your relationship at any age. That's my wonderful wife, Shanti, the kind of a life of God. She's just so good with preparing food, but she's also my yoga teacher. And she's been my yoga teacher for about 32 years. Next slide, please. And I've written a few books. The latest book isn't actually on that slide, but it's called Into the Nothing. And I just finished that. It's out there. And Infinite Light Publishers is what I go through. Okay, next slide, please. It's 13 different books. Next slide. And what I'm sharing really isn't anything new. This is Genesis 1:29. God said, "Behold, I have given you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit. It should be to you for food." I mean, what's new about that? Nothing. And we have a very long history of live vegan approach to health. Next slide, please. And I'm going to point this out. So we back 6,000 years BC, we have Anunnakis and the Genesis diet, which is what we just said. And then 3000 BC, we had a group in southern Greece called the Pelagians. Their average age was 200. And I actually went to Greece to track them down. It really was in southern Greece, but that's true. Average age is 200 in terms of, and pretty much 100% vegan and mostly by food. And then, surprise, you know, Akhenaten and Nefertiti, the pharaoh and the pharaoh of Tis, were definitely doing vegan-like food, 1300 approximately BC. And then things faded out. We had the Essenes. They really moved into live foods about 500 BC. Now, how do I know that? Because Pythagoras studied with them. Not too far from where I live now, okay? Half hour drive from where I live in the Carmel region at approximately 570 to 495 BC. And he came down a life of vegan and he started a whole movement. So that came from his studies with the Essenes. So they were around not just at Qumran and 70, you know, BC, but really 500, 600 years BC. And then the Romans came and everything got went backwards and everybody kind of disappeared. And it was kind of lost. The next emerging came in the 1880s, 1850s with Dr. a little bit before Dr. Bertrand Brenner, but then Dr. Bertrand Brenner, 1890s, using it to heal cancer. And then Max Gerson, cancer, but also diabetes. He healed Albert Einstein of diabetes type 2. So even my work with diabetes, although it's breakthrough at a certain level, I'm not the first one, okay? Max Gerson was already doing it. And then we had Dr. Edmund Bordeaux-Cayley, who started the modern kind of a scene movement in 1929. And then you had Ann Widmer in the 1950s. And the next round was myself and Victor Kovenskis and Brian Clement, kind of bringing the next wave of it. So there's this whole progression about the live food vegan diet. And so what's important is to understand this is not a new idea. Okay, that's what I want you to get. It's literally thousands of years old, 6,000 to 8,000 years old. So know you're part of something. What I'm sharing is something that's been around and it's been tested over time. Next slide, please. So this is Akhenaten and Nefertiti, and you see, what do they have there? We have sunlight that they're eating, and they're eating all the kind of black food vegan. So, okay, next slide. Okay, now, Thomas Edison was not a vegan, okay? But he said something really, really important. The chief function of the body is to carry the brain around. And so, really, if we understand our consciousness is extremely important, and then when we have a healthy body, it supports our consciousness. Now, as I've been doing research with this, I work also as an orthomolecular psychiatrist as well as a holistic physician, and I do a lot of supporting people's neurotransmitter development because under stress, people diminish in their neurotransmitters significantly. But what I discovered with the vegan live food diet is it actually enhanced all the neurotransmitters and brought it into balance. And that was like interesting. I wrote a book called Depression Free for Life. And I was like, whoa, ooh, all these different ways of looking at things. And it's like, my goodness, okay. If we just do the live food, and it's not as fast as supplements, but it works. It may take a year or two, versus supplements may take 3 months, but it works. And the principle is a live food vegan diet over a period of time will rebalance all your neurotransmitters and increase the ones that are need to be increased and decrease the ones that are in excess. So when we're eating this way and living this kind of way, we're doing the chief function of the body, which is to carry the brain around. Next slide, please. So diet affects consciousness because you have to have a functioning mind. It affects your thoughts. It affects your actions. So very clearly, what I'm saying is that when we have a healthy body, we have more balanced emotions, we have a more balanced mind, and ultimately we have the expansion of consciousness, which is part of the talk that we're talking about, is spiritual nutrition. How to eat in a way to become a superconductor of the divine. It seems simple, but it takes a while to get there. Next slide, please. So, it also has to do with appreciating that food is a love note from God. So it's a whole consciousness. So when we're eating, we're not gobbling. Okay, we're not a bunch of turkeys here. We're not gobbling. Each bite is releasing a certain amount of spiritual energy as well as caloric energy. And when we're eating with that consciousness, we're in essence taking in the sacred, we're making eating a sacred act. That's what we're doing. And we're taking in the spiritual energy of the food. And that's important. Now, is this again a new idea? Well, it's my kind of statement, but we know what the Buddha taught, and we know what some of the ancient teachers taught, which again, when you go vegan, you're not taking in the animal ego consciousness. And so you're also, one of my teachers, Swami Prakashananda, said, you know, when we kill an animal, we create pain, fear, and misery. And when we eat that animal, the flesh, we're taking pain, fear, and misery into us. And I just take it a step further, and that blocks all levels of our body, our physical body, our subtle bodies, our spiritual bodies, you know, our soul energy. It blocks all that. Now, it doesn't totally block it, but it decreases the flow. I notice this because in a very practical way, because all this is practical, back in 1975, given my background, somebody looked at that, and we had kind of a traveling ashram, a few thousand people. And I noticed, and then wherever we went, we saw people. I noticed that people who had too much energy going began to eat meat. I said, why is that? You're not supposed to be doing that in this. And the reason is, they said, it helps slow the energy. It helps dampen the energy. So clinically speaking, people are telling me meat slows the energy. So it's not a theoretical thing. I saw it from my clinical experience. So yes, if there's too much energy, you can't help. I'm not recommending it. There's better ways to do it, but that's what people were choosing. And I learned from that. And on the other hand, a vegan live food diet acts as a amplifier of the spiritual energy, an amplifier of the Kundalini. And now I'll explain, and I'm going to explain it again another way, that we have what are called nadis, or energetic channels in us, kind of like meridians, but they're not quite the same, but similar. And there's three main channels, Ida, Pingala, and Sushumna. Now, why is that important? Because those are the main channels through which the spiritual energy flows. And I began to observe, again, if people had more energy than they could handle, they would, meat, fish, chicken, and dairy would act as a sludge to this flow of the spiritual energy called Kundalini. It's like, wow, that was a huge lesson, just observing what people did. That impressed me. So on the other hand, the live food diet enhances the flow because it has no obstacles. Okay, so that's the key concept. So in these 72,000 nadis with three main ones, it unblocks the flow of the energy. So it amplifies it in people. Next slide, please. So how does it all work? Well, what I saw when people did live food vegan diet, an 87%, we did a study of about 300 people, one of my master's students, and we saw 87% improvement in emotional balance, mental clarity, and spiritual inspiration. Now, just think about that. And my own research, I saw actually a 95%, but I'm just kind of going with what this person did with a sample of 300 people. 400% decrease in depression. Now, remember what I said. When you're eating this natural way, you're balancing and raising all your neurotransmitters. and the neurotransmitters are, you know, serotonin, dopamine, pleasure centers, they naturally help depression and anxiety go away. So we have a 400% decrease in depression, a 300% decrease in anxiety. I mean, that's huge. And it's not temporary. If you kind of look at antidepressants, which are associated, some of them, with up to four times the amount of suicide, they don't tell you that. But when I was a resident in psychiatry, because of my background in biochemistry, I actually began teaching psychopharmacology. That's a long time ago, okay? I don't use any of those now. Because why? If I can get a 400% decrease in depression and a life with that, why would I want to take an antidepressant that can actually make you suicidal and only last, if it works, for 6 to 8 weeks? It's 300% decrease in anxiety, 32% decrease in addiction. Now, I want to say that I see a much higher result with the decrease in addiction because addiction has to do with a deficient dopamine. Why? What's dopamine have to do with it? It activates the pleasure centers. And people who are addicted to drugs, they're needing the drugs to activate their pleasure centers, although they activate less and less and less over time. So I see that this helps tremendous amount in breaking through with addictions. And what I also see, we're still doing fasting retreats over the internet, kind of international fasting retreats, that between 5 and 7 days on a green juice fast, half diluted, pretty much people break their addictions. And that's the easy way to go about it. Because the addictions, kind of move out of the body. And what I'm talking about is the biochemical part of the addiction. Not so much the mental part, but the biochemical, physical addiction level is usually carried in 5 to 7 days. So I get a very high percentage when I'm doing people with the juice fast. We're supervising a group juice fast around the world. I think our next one is in August. So it works. I've just seen consistently it works. And then a 300% increase in good to excellent energy levels. That's what we're talking about with being able to do 2,000 push-ups. Okay, an improvement in the immune system. That's colds, flus. When we really look at, the kind of viral things that are going on today without mentioning names, the key is what we call the terrain, which is your basic level of immune system function. That's the most important thing. And that was really a breakthrough in the 1880s. Louis Pasteur said one bacteria, one virus, one disease. And the other people said, no, the terrain, your general health. Anton Beauchamp, who had lots of MDs and PhDs, their position is, no, your quality of health is what really protects you. But that's why they call it the terrain. That's why in today's world, the most important thing we can do is build the terrain. And when you're really healthy, you see a lot less people getting sick from a variety of things. I'll just put it that way. Next slide, please. Okay, chronic disease. Now, the lady before talked about all the difficulties kids have, and I would say there's a statistic from 1989. At that point, kids, and I have three grandchildren in this process, in 1989, only 12% of kids were having ADD and things like that. Now it's close to 50%. Now, and I really don't mean ADD only, but chronic disease. About 50% of kids, believe it or not, since the vaccinations and other things in 1989 till now, are now having chronic disease. This is preventable and somewhat reversible. But I don't want to make claims here. The woman that did this research, one of the things that was in her mind is menstrual comfort. And she particularly was acute with that. And she was saying, well, it's a 200% decrease in menstrual discomfort. Okay. Wow. And I find that, it's like, if you're having, troubles, let's do something simple like start fasting, go to live foods and see what happens. And I think that's pretty accurate, a 200% increase in mental discomfort. We say it in a positive way. Significant decrease in constipation. We know that cooked food really takes a much longer time to get through the gastrointestinal tract. But the live vegan food goes through the fastest. And therefore, it sounds like a lot, 18,000% decrease in laxatives. Basically, you don't need laxatives. And a 20-fold decrease in antacid use. And that's because the stomach is beginning to function right. The trick to understanding antacids is that people who are feeling acid is because they don't have enough acid. So how does that work? Well, when you have enough acid, you'll have the emptying of what we call the pyloric valve, which is the bottom of the stomach, okay? Enough acid, boom, it opens, food goes through. But not enough acid, and it comes back up, and you get that acid indigestion. So when you're doing live food and you're eating less and your system is being stimulated, you actually increase your acid production. So at this age, most people start on digestive enzymes when they're in their 40s, 45. I stopped using digestive enzymes about 10 years ago. So it makes you stronger. I actually didn't believe it, but we're all our own experiment. So it's like, great, let's stop digestive enzymes. Because I've always thought everybody should take digestive enzymes. So what I found is, didn't need them. So over time, again, the body gets stronger. The powers of digestion get stronger. And I'm talking about hydrochloric acid and general digestive enzymes. That's what I'm talking about. Your five senses get more tuned in. Dr. Breckman in Russia did this really good research with mice, and he found a 200% increase in energy levels. He's now, I believe, in Canada. But there we go again. See. It's not just your psyche, because it's mice. And so he found that they just had increased energy. Next slide. Now, let's take a look at it from a different angle, okay? And let's look at it as what I call unbroken ecological wholeness. Interesting concept. What I mean is, when you cook it, you disrupt it. So this is a picture of a cabbage leaf. The bottom picture is a raw cabbage leaf, and the upper one is a cooked one. And Fritz Popp, who's still alive in Germany, explains about the living field has the highest amount of biophoton energy. And so what we see, with a little imagination, we can see that the bottom, the cabbage leaf, has a lot more energy than the top one. It's cooked. Okay, it's still got its advantages, but Fritz Popp did some really interesting research because he was able to measure these things. And he found that people eating junk food had a biophoton energy of about 1,000. People eating organic but cooked had 23,000, and people who were doing a kind of mixed with live food, but organic, vegan had 43,000. Live food people, eating primarily live food, at least 80%, had 83,000 biophotons. And if you combine that with some Chinese herbs, the longevity herbs, which I do use, reishi and heishi wu and goji berries, you get up to 116,000. That's a lot versus even 83 with all live food. So it helps. So what happens with it is there's more energy. When there's more energy, the subtle organizing energy flow, which is the energetic matrix, so to speak, on which the physical exists, gets stronger and more focused, so we have more strength. Next slide, please. And then power of caloric restriction. What is that there? That's a sprout, okay? That's a little, that's more than a little bit of energy. But Steve Spindler, around 2001, showed that if you decrease your food intake by 40%, you actually increased and actually turned on your anti-aging genes. And I think that, well, I agree. So I have to say, and again, this is over time. I don't really have dinner. I'll have a big, you know, a medium salad at lunch. And I'm not a person who needs a lot of protein. And then then the breakfast, I'll just have a little bit of a kind of a herbal drink, okay, with my goji berries and cacao and ginger, which I like. Okay, so membrane potential is the cell becomes a better battery when you're using the live food. And being a better battery, there's going to be more energy. And that's the genetic upgrade that we're called from Sweden. It didn't change your genes. It upgraded your genes. That's the important thing, to their highest expression. Next slide. So look at the energy. This is live. This is another kind of high energy supplement. We're not promoting any particular supplement here, so I'm not going to mention where it came from. But it's, see how balanced it is. The other thing is energy enzyme preservation. Dr. Howe, even in the 30s, began talking about it. Because the live food, when you cook food, it has self-digesting enzymes, and they get destroyed. And we clearly, the raw food is also more alkalizing and mineralizing, and those matrices, the chelating matrices, are not upset. Zeta potential is the water energy in the cell, and that, again, keeps it at a high level. Now, here's the biotoxicity. It takes 24 to 36 hours for food pass through. The cooked food is 40 to 100 hours. Okay, so there's a big difference. And the longer it's in your system, the more potential for toxicity it has. And when we eat carbohydrates, it causes acrylamide, which is kind of a carcinogen. Next slide, please. So Paul Kontrakoff in the 30s. And cooked food overactivates and exhausts the immune system. And I'm going to qualify this because one of my master's students actually tried to repeat this, his study. And what this person found was really interesting to me, to be honest with you. What she found was that cooked vegetables or not did not cause an overt immune response. It was the junk food. People had a hot dog or something like that. Then it overactivated and exhausted the immune system. But if you just had cooked organic vegetables, it didn't seem to make a difference. So I thought that was interesting. And we have to check out the research is done. Otherwise, we're using statements that were, that was 30, that's almost 90 years ago. It's like, well, it's not quite true. Somewhat true. Okay. And then I talked about moving the outer light to the inner light. Okay, so that we're really, we're like a big leaf, okay? And when we are free to just absorb the sunlight into ourselves, we get the energy right away. Now, I kind of got this idea as the sun dancer, the Native American sun dancer. And there you dance without food and water for 4 days. And I saw there was a difference. And then the last year, I did what we call an eagle dance. I won't go into the whole sun dance, but basically, you have the hooks in your chest for 4 days, whereas the other ones, it's just for an hour or two. I didn't leave the circle. I was out in the sun 4 days straight. I was the only one to make it through that way out of about 60 people. Okay, so what did I learn from that? Well, I didn't get sunburned. Now, how is it possible that I didn't get sunburned, but people with darker skin got sunburned? How is it possible I was the only one to make it through never leaving the circle? I took an enema before the dance and all that, okay, but I didn't have to leave the circle. And I realized that I was eating the sun. I was actually getting stronger. At the end of 4 days without food and water, I was feeling great and really getting strong. I was like, how can that be? Well, transfers the outer light into the inner light. I became like a plant. And I was like, whoa. And then I did research because that's the way I like to do things. Okay. And there was some research going on in Germany where they were treating cancer patients, and they found that when they put them on the live foods, they were able to be in the sun 4 times longer without getting sunburned. So that further reinforced the idea that we become like a plant. We're taking in the sunlight and using that directly as energy. So that's what I mean by outer light into the inner light. So I'm just mentioning that. I'm not asking, I'm not suggesting people do that without some level of preparation, obviously. 4 days without food and water in the hot sun, and with mid the sun dance, spirit dance, you're just wearing a skirt and nothing on top. So it's like, you're really exposed. So not getting sunburned, it's like, how did that happen? So that's my theory of how we become like plants. Think about that. That's so trippy. We're actually eating the sunlight. It's the only explanation I have, because I'm the only one that didn't get sunburned, and I was the only one out there the whole time. Okay, so it's best for optimizing spiritual life and life in general on the planet. And there are multiple reasons for that, which we're going to go into in just a moment. Next slide, please. Okay, what is that? That's kind of like a limit. What we're seeing is food has energy, and you can take it in, and that energy goes directly into you. That's a good deal. Next slide, please. Okay, that's a radish sprout. It's phenomenal. So when we're eating these foods, if we make it a sacred act, it's like we can feel the energy. Of course, you have to chew it, but you can feel the energy. Next slide, please. And that's a corn sprout. Next slide. This is Karelian photography. This is cacao. I'm not going to give a long talk on cacao, but it turns out that it's extremely good even for treating diabetes, but for increasing blood flow to the brain and to the heart significantly. It's a tremendous amount of energy. Next slide. This is raw cacao. I'm not cooked. Here's a person, same person. On the left, you see there's a fingerprint and they're eating good organic food. On the right, they're eating junk food. This is an experiment and there's no aura, there's no field. That's how big it is. Next slide, please. And this is the pineal gland, and you can see that white light there. That is, I think, an important thing to understand is we are actually activating our internal organs, and it gets increased when we're eating the live food. Next slide. That's the pituitary gland. So understand these have frequencies, and our intake affects these, the empowerment of these frequencies. Next slide, please. Okay, that's epinephrine. Next slide. I'm sorry, that's norepinephrine. This is epinephrine. It's wound 3.5 times, and you see the crystalline structure of these hormones that are activated. Next slide. This is very straight, it's testosterone. So whereas the women is more rounded, with the men it's testosterone. Women need testosterone too. Next slide, please. And this is women, this is estrogen. Next slide. Okay, so now we're prepared to talk about spiritual nutrition. And what I'm showing you here is nadis. The two snakes represent the nadis. They're coming together at the third eye kind of level here. And where they cross is the chakra levels. And the name of the game is to clear the nadis so that everything becomes energized. The two wings are the right and left side of the brain, and that you can barely see it, but in the very center of that yellow column going up is the Brahma nadi, and that's a subtle nadi, goes all the way to the merging of the, it looks like Star David, but it's the higher forces coming down to meet the lower forces in the kind of the Om understanding of things. But the Brahma nadi is the only nadi that goes beyond the third eye. And these are things you experience in meditation, and they really exist. I mean, that's how I know about it, because I experience it, but I look it up. Next slide, please. So what we're going for in, let's say, the Ayurvedic system is the word ojas. It's the deep primordial vigor and reserve. Deep primordial vigor and reserve. The deep life force. In Chinese medicine, it's called jing. You'll want to build the jing. We have prenatal and postnatal. And why that's important is you can build the ojas and the postnatal jing. That's your overall life force, okay? And even if you're not genetically given a lot of the ojas, you can build it. And that's the key here. That's the point. It's always an optimism. You can do this. Next slide. So let's look at the ojas building foods. Ojas is deeper than sexual energy. Okay, but sexual energy is a reflection of the ojas or of the jing. And then above jing comes qi. So the jing is deeper. So what are your really good things? The omega, long chain omega-3s, the plant-based protein, which is very different than animal-based protein. I mentioned bee pollen. Some people think, well, that's not vegan. Some people say it is. You can also get vegan that's not been activated by the bees. Blue-green algae, E3 Live, chlorella, spirulina, these are high concentrate proteins. An egg is 44% protein, but chlorella is up to 65, 70, and spirulina 65, 70% protein, depending, but it's about 95% assimilated, where an egg is maybe 12% assimilated. Coconut oil, hemp seed oil, some of these are oil, avocado, nut and seed milks. Those are your, you know, kind of high level, deep building foods. Herbs, I'm not going to go, of course, but shatavari, and then your the ginseng, maca from South America, licorice rhodiola, which is very active, goji berries, which people don't think is herb, but it's one of the top three longevity herbs, astragalus, and immune, reishi, schizandra, and gynam stevia. I know more about gynam stevia because it's really good for diabetes as well. Now, what also builds it? Adequate sleep. In general, even though you can get away with less sleep, research suggests people need about 7 hours. They need that 7 hours somewhere between, you know, around 10:30 to 2:30. Those are your high rebuilding hours. And that builds your serotonin as well. Love of God, sexual balance, meaning the right balance can increase your ojas. Excess will decrease it. Moderate lifestyle. I see people working that just work too hard. And how do you know you're working too hard? Because you feel tired. How do you know you're not working too hard? You feel really good all the time. You don't get tired. That's how you do it. It's clinically based. It's not like there's a one formula. But one of the messages I'm giving is there's no one formula about this. But if you're feeling full of energy all the time, you know you're on the right track. Okay? And that's good. And then minimizing the news and sense controls, things like that. Now, what depletes it? Overworking, too much restraint, not enough sleep. Drug use is one of the big things that deranges that, what we call prana and tejas, the fire, as well as ojas. The prana, tejas, and ojas are the three kind of big elements when we talk about energies. And tejas is like the fire. Prana is like the air element. So drug use is very, very depleting. And it takes a year or two to build people back. You can do it. I do it all the time for people. But it takes a while. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's look again about a vegan lifestyle because we need to see the big picture here. First, it preserves the germ cell. That's that's the part that we reproduce, the sperm and the ovum. And it gives us healthy reproduction. They did a study, and that's why I want to make a little clarity. They studied women who were eating kind of food that wasn't organic, and they had a very high percentage of infertility. And when they were switched to organic food and just fruits and vegetables, they had significant improvement in fertility. That's what we're talking about. Personal health, vitality, and energy. Okay, so we know, you know, people on a vegan diet, because they didn't say live food, they have 32% less heart disease. High blood pressure is 26%, meat eaters, 2% in vegans, okay? Osteoporosis, 4 times higher in meat eaters, men and women. Diabetes, 35 to 50% more diabetes in meat eaters. So those are just some examples. It's pretty big. Feeds the hungry. Well, if the whole world were vegan, we would have enough food to feed the world 7 times over. We wouldn't be talking about starvation. The data is variable, whether it's 20 million or 40 million people starving to death each year. And of course, all the stuff they're talking about today, we're really talking about enough food to feed everybody if we went vegan, because the animal agriculture takes about 70% of the arable land. Vegan agriculture takes 5%. So first, we have a lot more land. Water, it's about 4,500 gallons of water versus 300 gallons for vegans. So whether it's 14 times less, roughly speaking. So that's pretty significant. So you need less in land and less water. We can feed everybody. And if it were all live food, it would be 12 times over. Enough food to feed the world 12 times over. And then we're hearing all the time, we're going to have famine, we're going to have that. Well, that's because of how they've arranged it and because people aren't really you know, being vegan and or live food. Okay. Obviously, it protects against the animal cruelty. It preserves the ecology, as I'm explaining, because you're using up a whole lot less resources in the big picture. And it maintains and protects, in essence, the computer mind. So this is like helps protect the whole world, really. And we're seeing a collapse of that. If everybody said we're going to deal with this by going vegan, it would change the politics in a big way. Next slide, please. So we're talking about the conscience of sovereignty, yama niyamas, the do's and don'ts, the 10 speakings or commandments, inner peace, because you're not taking death in. I mentioned nadis and koshas, layers of the mind. Nadis were what we talked about, Ida Pingala. And basically, it's the diagnosis associated with spirituality and enlightenment in all the in all the traditions. Next slide, please. So, but here's the attitude. That's where people get in trouble. It's not about moral superiority. It's about being responsible for the impact of our actions. Hey, if you can feed the world 7 times over by being vegan, well, that's a good idea. And 12 times over by being, you know, live food, that's a good idea. You're being responsible for the result of your actions. And that's really the point of that. And the water, I mentioned 300 gallons of water versus 4,500. It's like, oh, that's a big difference in terms of the world having limited fresh water. Next slide, please. Okay, so people say, well, there are dangers here. But we're going to skip through this little piece here a little bit, but go ahead. They call it spleen deficiency. It doesn't. It's just the opposite. How did that research, how did that myth get going? Well, in the 1930s, the Chinese were having food famine, and people who couldn't afford anything except a little vegetables and rice became weak and, you know, died from starvation. Whereas the wealthy people, they were eating meat and doing different things. And so it said, well, it's because you were a vegan. No, it isn't because you're vegan. It's because you didn't have any food and you were starving. Next slide. So whistling the deficiency as you, you know, kind of decline, you have blood sugar imbalances, weight problems, obesity, alcoholism, drug abuse, low vitality, chronic fatigue. These are all things that happen. The treatment for this is actually live food vegan. Next slide. Because small chi is good energy, endurance, ability to grow and learn, good memory, and emotional balance, which is exactly what we're talking about with a live food vegan diet. Next slide. But of course, it depends that you have enough food that you're not starving to death. So people made wrong conclusions. So a live food vegan cuisine is a cure for spleen chi deficiency. Next slide. Not a cause. Okay, we call vata balance. Kapha, pitta, and vata are Ayurvedic terms. Pitta is fire, vata is air, kapha is kind of water and earth. And if you aren't grounding yourself, you can get a vata balance, but here's the cure to that. Next slide. So you need high oil content foods like avocado, nut and seed pate, soaked nuts and seeds. And vata people are actually rebalanced by warm, oily, sweet, salty, watery, soupy cuisine. And then moderate use of spices, like asafoetida, cumin, ginger, and garlic. So that's how, you know, that balances it. And you can be 100, you can be a full vata and be 100% my food. I've had many people be successful that way. Next slide. So it's not that complicated. As Ralph Waldo Emerson said, society's always taken by surprise by any new example of common sense. And what I'm saying is common sense. You have to be the experiment. You have to explore for yourself and find the right balance. That's what I'm saying. I'll give you an example. Next slide, please. We looked at protein. Some people, about 30% of the people need a lower protein, about 35 grams, and 70% need a higher protein, about 70 grams. And with age, you actually need more protein. So about close to 15 years ago, I was doing pull-ups, and I was stuck at 25. When I was a football player, I could do 7, but I was stuck at 25. And then I read this data. Well, gee, if you're in your 60s, you actually need to have more protein. So I added 1 tablespoon of a protein concentrate. I think it was blue-green algae. And I jumped from 25 up to 50 and eventually 100 pull-ups. Just 1 tablespoon. And that's what we have to do. We have to be the experiment. We get guidelines. Yeah, well, I'm a person to eat much protein, or, you know, and I don't, you know, maybe 10, 12% of my diet at this point is protein. It works for me. Other people need to have 20%. Okay, but we have to explore this. We have to experiment. Okay, so now, meat eaters and vegans are low in DHA, which is a long chain omega-3. Generally speaking, particularly if you're pregnant, you need to take some sort of supplement of DHA because you need a lot, and post-pregnancy as well to recover. 80% are deficient in magnesium. Now that, again, is vegans and meat eaters, and 75 to 95% of people are deficient in iodine. Now, iodine isn't just for your thyroid. It's for your adrenal. It's for your ovaries. It's for your hypothalamic function. It's for your pineal function. So you need a lot of it, okay? And then about B12. Oh, if you're a vegan, you're going to be B12 deficient. Well, it turns out that 40% of meat eaters are B12 deficient. And I learned that at Columbia Medical School. And it was like, oh, okay. Yes, more vegans are B12 deficient at 200 nanograms, which is the minimum. And 80% of meat eaters, 90% of vegans need around 400 to 450 nanograms of human active B12. It's got to be human active B12. What's my bottom line as I write in my books? Everybody should take a human active B12 supplement because our foods are not containing enough because of deficient soils. So that's kind of how to understand that. So everybody should be doing that. I suggest everybody needs the iodine and also magnesium. I'm not going to mention any products because that's part of what we're not doing here. But these are really critical factors. Next slide, please. Carnosine is something that really just meat eaters get, but everybody's deficient. And in 1936, congressional report said 99% of the U.S. population is deficient in minerals. So we need a lot of high mineral foods that are out there. Shilajit's one of them. And then vitamin D is a big problem. 85% of Americans are low in vitamin D. Minimum is 30 milligrams per milliliter, but we need closer to 80. And that, of course, protects you against all kinds of viral infections. Next slide, please. And the vitamin K, protects the right blood balance. Women and men need slightly different ones. And the vitamin A is an interesting problem because there's not a really good solution because it doesn't convert. The beta carotenes don't convert that well in the vitamin A. Really, some people only get 9% conversion. So what's my answer? It is to have a vitamin A supplement, which can be vegan. Next slide, please. So, cuisine versus diet. Cuisine is a style. Vegan raw food is the style. And the diet is macronutrient ratio. Next slide. And so let's take a look at that. So we've got to get the right ratio for who we are. We are unique. On chromosome 19, it actually says how much carbohydrate, how much fat, and how much protein we need. It's actually in our genes. It tells us we aren't a bunch of cows. We don't just eat grass and everything's fine. We have to individualize our diet. This lecture isn't going to be about that. That's an important principle. And there's ways, if you go to my website, drcousens.com, it will kind of take you to treeoflife.mn.co. And I have a chart that people can fill out and kind of get a rough idea. Fast, slow oxidizer type thing. Next slide. So, 2013, genome-wide meta-analysis, association of a locus and a chromosome 19, that's what I'm talking about, carbohydrate, fat, and FTO locus with protein intake. So it tells you how much you need. And we are unique individuals. And we have to understand we are unique. There is no one diet for everybody. Very important principle. Next slide. That's where the success lies. Now, on top of that, at different ages, we need different inputs. As I explained, in my, you know, at 65, it's like, wait, I need a little bit more protein. And I went from 25 to 100 pull-ups. Okay, one tablespoon. So as we started as kapha, watery, blubbery, lots of earaches, particularly if you have dairy, except mother's milk. And then once you have puberty, we call pitta, that fiery quality. And then finally, vata. Now, people are moving into vata at earlier and earlier ages. And having a good vata balancing diet, sweet, salty, oily, watery foods, rubbing oil on your skin, things like that are balance the vata. So you can really optimize your vata energy. Next slide, please. So what about protein and diet? Well, we've been talking about it. So a little bit of repetition here. Next slide. So 70% needs a higher amount. We call them fast oxidizers. Those are just a term, okay? 30% a lower amount, that's me. I'm a slow oxidizer, so I just needed one tablespoon and everything went into order. Next slide, please. So we can get adequate protein. That's the important thing in today's day and age. Next slide, please. So you can get it all from that. There's a catch, though. To get the adequate protein at some level, unless you're like me, who's a slow oxidizer and don't need my protein, you have to eat a bushel of greens. That's not too practical for a lot of people, but it's there, theoretically. Next slide. So let's look at top sources of veggie protein. Popeye, spinach, 49%. Kale, 45% protein. Broccoli, 45%. And we where we live here in Israel, there's a lot of organic food. And I just have to walk two blocks to an organic market. It's fresh within one day. That's the other thing. After 3 days, it loses a lot of its energy. So you want to go to local markets. At this market, I went to the farm and inspected it. That's my style. He's a guy from Switzerland. He's like, towed me into it. And, food's delivered fresh by 8 in the morning. to our local market, which is a few blocks from here. So fresh spinach, kale, broccoli, cauliflower is 40% protein. Mushrooms are really good, 38%, plus they're good for your immune system. And there's parsley and cucumbers, cabbage, tomatoes. And there we have protein and meat. Beef is 25.8% protein. Chicken is 23%. Well, that's less than half of what spinach is. But it's in animal and meat, it's concentrated. You don't have to eat a bushel. Eggs are 12% protein, as I mentioned, with 44% assimilation. So the point is, there is plenty of protein, but you got to eat a lot. So I take a tablespoon of the blue-green algae each day, okay? Also, there's pea protein you can use. So it's available. That's my point, okay? Next slide. Okay, and what about fish? Well, tuna is 29%, sardines are 25%, trout 23%, wild salmon 22%. So it's nowhere near your spinach at 49%. Cod, flounder is 13%, but they're more concentrated. I don't really recommend it because at this point, all the waters in the world are polluted mostly. And so you're getting a lot of toxins in the water and in that. But what we know is the fat in the animal products has 95 to 96% of all the pesticides and herbicides. So it's high concentrations. Next slide. Nuts and seeds, how do they work? Next slide. And this is an important piece here. So they did a study of 119,000 people over 30 years. Now that's a one good study. And they saw that nut eaters, okay, had a 7% reduced risk of death from any cause. That's pretty good. Once a week, 11%. 2 to 4 times a week, 13%. And if you're having nuts and seeds every day, as I do, 20% reduce in risk of death. And eating nuts was linked to low risk of cancer, heart disease, and respiratory. Just the opposite of what happens when you eat meat. That's New England Journal of Medicine. And they're not exactly pro-vegan. Next slide, please. So it's exciting. We can do it. These are some of the supplements. The point is there are protein concentrates that we have that can do the job for us. Next slide. We'll answer the questions in soon. So fat in the diet, well, that's good for fast oxidizers. Next slide. So here we go. Human breast milk contains 54% saturated fat. So it tells us nature wants us to have a little bit of fat. Next slide, please. So this is a study, it's in my diabetes book, about fat in the diet. I'm not a 10% fat person, okay? I'm actually, depending on the person, 25 to 45% fat, and that's plant fat, not animal fat. And 25 to 35% carbs versus the other two diets you see, also stated in orange, are 60 to 70% carbs, or 70, 75%. So why is this important? Well, let's look at the results. Well, SLC, they were on medications later, I think it's in other studies, but I don't have that data. So you want your triglycerides to be less, at least less than 100. So their triglycerides, which are not so healthy for you, if it's above 100. So on my diet, 69 versus 173 and 232. That is connected more to heart disease. But about cholesterol? Well, I find that you want a cholesterol. I'm going to say it this way. Women with a cholesterol of 270 live 28% longer versus women with a cholesterol of 193. So we have a cholesterol scare, which throws people off. If you're doing a vegan diet, you don't have to really worry, but our people average the cholesterol 160, 159, which is passable, works. Esselstein had a cholesterol 137, but they were on statins, which are really unhealthy for you. And Dean Orange to 173, which is a really good range. The diet, basically grains, legumes, and fruit for Esselstein, some egg whites. Ours were really no foods, grains, beans, or legumes, just nuts, seeds, and avocado. So you can see our diet works really pretty well. Again, we need a certain amount of triglycerides to be less than 100. And that's a remarkable thing. And our cholesterol is just fine. That's at 25 to 45% fat versus 10% fat. So actually, that's more the way it is in nature, 25 to 45. Next slide, please. And a lower carbohydrate. So cholesterol facts, 52,287 people with ages 20 to 74. And as I said, their cholesterol is 270 or higher had 28% lower mortality than women with the cholesterol less than 19. Now, that is a very important statement. That's a lot of people in a full age range. That's a good fact. Next slide. And 21 studies, they found, or 340,000, they found no difference in the risk of heart disease between people with the lowest and the highest intake of saturated fat. But that's a really important statement. And yes, some people have genetic problems, but that's 21 studies, 340,000 people. That's again, a statistical statement. Next slide. The Archives of Internal Medicine summed it up in 2009, a systemic review of the evidence supporting the causal link between dietary factors and coronary heart disease is published. Next slide, this is the punchline. There's no evidence to support the widespread, this is me obviously, not their thing, widespread mythical belief that limiting saturated fat intake is beneficial or protective for heart health or longevity. Again, I want to call it plant fat, not animal fat. There's a lot of toxins in the animal fat and they're higher in the food chain. So don't worry about these things. If you're going to be vegan and mindful, these things are not an issue. Having, you know, you're naturally going to have a lower cholesterol. Next slide. So this is a study with elderly people, 89 years and older. They found for each 39-point increase in total cholesterol, there's a 15% decrease in mortality because you need cholesterol to build your brain. So I'm giving you an anti, don't worry about cholesterol talk, because if you're vegan, it's just not going to be a problem. And really, the more cholesterol at a certain level makes your nervous system and brain work better. 15% decrease in mortality. Next slide, please. So, the National Institute of Health, high cholesterol is associated with better memory. And that is important. Next slide, please. So, this is the Boston study, 2005. There's, a fair amount of men and women. People with the highest cholesterol levels scored higher on cognitive tests than those with lower cholesterol. And people eating healthy fats are 42% less likely to have a cognitive impairment. We need the fat for our brain. So don't worry about fat if it's plant-based fat. Animal fat, a little different. Next slide, please. So that's the preferred fuel for human metabolism. That's the way it's been. Next slide. So you don't want to go less than 159, and here are the reasons why. Next slide, please. You need a low cholesterol increases emotional balance, increases depression and suicide, which is an extremely important issue. That's how I started tuning into the fat issue when I read the research in medical school. Increases violent behavior, stroke, accidents, hormonal imbalance, memory loss, Parkinson's. So we don't want a too low cholesterol. If you can get 159 or above, up to, you know, really with women 270, you're going to live 28% longer. Next slide. I know that pushes a few people's buttons because we're taught to fear cholesterol. And this is the omega-3s. It reduces the risk of death from all causes. That those with omega-3 of less than 4% age faster. Those with index of about 8%, they're healthier and age more slowly. Next slide. But if you're omega-3 deficiency, and that's a problem, and it is hard to get omega-3s easily on a vegan diet. You can get it from a certain yellow algae, which is how I get it. But it's connected with 96,000 premature deaths, particularly from heart disease and stroke. And it decreases premature death by 85%. Now those, that's something worth paying attention. So I do get an oil from yellow algae that give me the long chain omega-3s because it's that important. Next slide. I mean, I would like to say we can eat it all from the environment, but it's not so easy when we live. So you need the omega-3s for brain tissue, for brain and eye development. And I will tell you, postpartum depression, and that's very common. You do the long chain omega-3s, and DHA, particularly an EPA, DHA, 3 weeks. I don't care if you've had postpartum depression for 10 years. I've had cases like that, 10 years. You know, usually it's, 6 months you're feeling it. It reverses it. It improves mood regulation as well. Next slide. So long-chain omega-3s are important. Healthy brain, better memory, better cognition, better sleep, protects against neurodegenerative disease. I mean, there's a lot of goods here. And then helps produce a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine, which is helps stimulate GABA-aminobutyric acid, which helps you relax and kind of balances your parasympathetic, sympathetic system. So decreases anxiety, depression, panic attacks. Next slide. And it decreases the excess of norepinephrine, which can get you anxious. And I use it a lot when I treat bipolar disease. It really does help, particularly the EPA and the DHA, but the EPA is particularly bipolar. We can manage these things. You know, depression, fear for life, that's 90% of the people on the program are successful. And for manic depression without medication, except for a touch of lithium, 80% success rate. We can do it. I mean, it's pretty amazing to rebalance the system and see how good it is. Next slide. Okay. So again, the DHA, EPA, long-chain omega-3s decreases hostility, aggression, impulsivity, protects against cortisol excess, reduces the risk of Parkinson. You get better nerve signaling. Next slide. So it also turns out to be the preferred fuel for your heart. 85% lower risk of dying from all causes, lowers blood pressure, protects against excess clotting, which is an important thing today in today's world. Next slide. So this is the last of that. It does provide cancer benefits, particularly prostate cancer and breast cancer. Next slide. And skin cancer. Okay, carbohydrates. What about that? We got fats now. We're not going to worry about fats. Carbohydrates. Next slide. Okay. This is a really important thing. And of course, it's not just for women, but the jewel pound refers to the abode of female immortals. So if you mix and smoke and fire, your body will not walk into a pond. They're saying if you cook your food. The mortal body should be pure, clear spirit. If you do not abstain from cooked food, then ordinary murky energy will go in your body. So this is kind of, it's written more by women, but this is the teaching in the Taoist approach. Next slide. Okay. Bee goo, they don't recommend eating grains. The avoidance of grains goes back to 475 BC. It's still part of modern Taoism. Next slide. So that's just a little hint about grains because it's high carbohydrate. And we'll talk about fructose for a moment. And what we need to understand is immediately fructose doesn't raise your blood sugar, but in the long term, it really accelerates diabetes. So, and that's Gary Tobbs put it, and because it gets converted, carbohydrate gets converted into fat and causes insulin resistance. And the fat blocks insulin function in cells. Next slide. So I got more into this because of my work with diabetes. So it directly causes, it's associated with diabetes, especially with doing the high fructose corn syrup. And next slide. So incidence of diabetes increased 90% in the 2 years in the 1980s when it was introduced. High fructose corn syrup. Big problem. Next slide. And it also is associated with more liver disease. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Next slide. So they have 2 to 3 times more fructose with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So it's got fatty liver disease. It accelerates diabetes, cancer, and actually affects mental function. The glia cells of the brain are 10 times worse with fructose than with glucose. Next slide. Okay, fructose is 10 times more active in creating ages than glucose. Next slide. So cancer cells use fructose 10 times more than glucose. So now we're getting a little understanding of this. So how much is safe? Next slide. We're going to look at that. Basically, it also creates 10 times more inflammation in the brain. Go ahead, next slide. So we want between 15 and 25 grams a day that we can handle on fructose. Next slide. Okay, so we don't want to go over 25 grams. Next slide. So this is what excess fructose, and we think it's innocent because it doesn't immediately raise your blood sugar. You got heart disease, high blood pressure, obesity, gout, kidney stones, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, brain inflammation, cancer, accelerated aging. Next slide. So inflammation is the big thing, and that's the gluten and the high carbohydrate diet. Next slide. That's the grain brain. So, and high carbohydrate or blood sugar will accelerate brain shrinkage. We call it type 3 diabetes. Next slide. The brain shrinks a certain percent, but this accelerates it. So, it's about double the people who are kind of the highest kind of tendency with diabetes. So, and depression. Next slide. Oh, okay. So David Perlmutter said it pretty good in the grain brain. A diet heavy in inflammatory carbohydrates and low in healthy fat messes with the mind in more ways than one. And he said it pretty well. Next slide. That's why I quoted him. Nature made sugar out of get, man made it easy. And that's our part of our problem in our world today. Next slide. So what's my suggestion? 25 to 45% plant diet. This is general suggestion. You have to figure out whether you're 25 or 45, 10 to 20% protein, 25 to 40% carbohydrate, not 70% carbohydrate. Okay, and if you're going to do diabetes, get it down to 25 to 35% carbohydrate. And that's mostly your vegetables that we're talking about. Next slide. Okay, so let's think food is energy. And again, my bottom line is, how do you feel over a long period of time? How do you feel? Not for one day, but over a few months. You make a shift, you observe. You have to experiment on yourself, and you have to kind of balance it till you get your optimum result. Next slide. And only you can tell that. So here we are. Live food helps us become superconductors of the divine. Next slide. That's the kundalini energy. So in each generation, we're given the right medicine for the world's repair. Holistic live food begins as the medicine for healing today's world. I'll go a step further. It is the wave of the present and the future in every level. Next slide. Now, you may feel bad about the state of our world, but it will be okay because people like you are in. Consider that. Because people who are part of this conference are at the vanguard. What we do makes a difference. If we turn eating into a sacred way of living, we turn our diet and a vegan way of life, we can transform the world. Okay, next slide, please. And that's how you reach me, drcousins.com or info@treeoflife.nu. And I actually still am taking new patients here in Israel. I mean, I see people all over the world on the internet. Okay. Now we can go to questions if we have some.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cousens. This is Ben from The Real Truth again. And that was incredibly meaningful for all of us on so many different levels. And we really, really appreciate that. We do have a little bit of time for some questions. And but I just want to make sure everybody knows you just showed your website. If anybody wants to get some of your books, should they go to that website? Or where's the best place to get all your books as well?
Get it. They can the website, you can get it. And also, you can get them at any store, Amazon and so that's kind of, they're all over the place.
Got it.
But you can get it from our website. That's easy too.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you, and thank you again for that. And so we are going to start our Q&A, our live Q&A with people, and want to make sure that you and our audience knows exactly how we go about that here at the Real Truth About Health Conference. We ask people to raise their virtual hand, and we take their hands in the order in which they come in. I see some coming in already. For those of you that don't know how to go about doing this, what you're going to do is on the bottom of your Zoom window, you're going to see different tabs. One of those tabs is the reactions tab. You click on your reactions tab and you go ahead and click on the function that says raise hand, and your hand will be raised. We take those raised hands again in the order in which we receive them. I will go ahead and call on the person whose turn is next, and we'll unmute you and you can go ahead with your question for Dr. Cousens. Again, we just have a few minutes, so we want to get to as many people as we possibly can. And so with that, we ask everybody to try to keep it to one question and stay on topic. That would be great. I'm going to go ahead and set them up. If you'll knock them down, Dr. Cousens, you ready?
I'm always ready.
We know that about you. All right. Hang on one second. And our first person up looks like Lorraine. Lorraine, I am unmuting you now. Hi, Lorraine.
Hi, I'm Lorraine from Southern California. I'm an 80-year-old woman, 5'1", weigh 150 pounds. I want to know what you think about grains in my diet. How much do you think I should eat a day?
I would keep it minimal. I would go because there's some weight, and the grains accelerate that, and it kind of lowers your mental functioning. So I would keep it at a minimum, maybe once a day at max, and go with the fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds. More live food is what I'm saying versus the cooked.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Cousens. I'm going to go ahead and...
I'm just going to mention one other place for my books is Infinite Light Publishing. That's my basic publisher, but okay, go ahead.
Excellent. That was Infinite Light Publishing, right?
Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, so once again, now we've got up next David A. I'm gonna unmute you. Hi, David.
Hi, how you doing?
Great, great. Welcome.
Dr. Cousens, thank you very much. Can you please tell us where you get the yellow algae you mentioned in your presentation? How do we get that?
You can go to kind of my website, and it will direct you. I do have a kind of worldwide online, okay? And that's probably the best way to go. Just look, it will guide you to that. Because I spent a lot of time getting just the right thing. I guess you can figure that out. So you can go to Dr. Cousens Global, and it's kind of how you can kind of get the products, and then they'll ship them to you.
Thanks, doctor. That's great.
It's from New Hampshire. It's not from Israel.
Excellent. Thank you again. And up next, we have Wendy. I'm going to ask you. I'll unmute you. Okay. Hi, Wendy.
Hi, Wendy Eden Harris here in Boca Raton. My question is, how do I get satiated when I am doing vegan? If you're not adding fats, and then also about seeds, is it essential to grind the chia and the hemp seeds? Because I just throw them in my salad and let them soak up the extra liquid, but I don't grind them. Is it essential to grind the smaller seeds?
My point of view, chia seeds, I would soak them overnight and then become a gel. And they have many, many good qualities. That's the easy way to do it. I don't really grind up the smaller seeds, but that's kind of the answer to that question. The other question is, fat doesn't make you fat, carbohydrates do. So I would look at the excess of carbohydrates in your diet. That's a myth that fats make you fat. It's the carbohydrates that create fat and gain weight. Just a little tidbit.
Okay. Thanks. That's great. Thank you. Next, we're going to bring up Patrick. And hi, Patrick. Welcome.
Oh, hi. Hi. My name's calling from London, UK. Just wanted to ask, in relation to live foods, they're normally uncooked. How about teas? What's your thoughts on teas? I'm assuming that they need to be heated to get the benefits. So just want to get your feedback on herbal teas.
Herbal teas. Well, I think the research shows that green teas, particularly matcha green tea, really has many, many important immune things. And actually, in terms of COVID, I've written out publicly that there are five components in it that actually protect you against viral replication and spike protein. So matcha green tea is really, of the hot things in teas, it is really pretty good for you. So that's my thoughts on it.
Thanks, doctor. And up next we have Ainsley. And hi, Ainsley, welcome.
Hi, everyone. Good day, Dr. Trinidad. My question is, one, the pictures that you showed us with the explosion, or let's say the firework explosion of foods when they're in us, how long does that last in our system? And secondly, anything about grounding? I was looking forward to hearing your explanation on grounding, walking on Mother Earth barefoot. Thanks.
Okay, so... it's a good question. So what you're seeing is clearly photography. Once you take in, and that energy is transferred directly into us. So it doesn't last long. It's transferred to us. That's the good news, right? Now, grounding, I think I've looked at a lot of different grounding things. And I do prayers in the morning, and I'm out there barefoot on the ground, pulling in the energy from the earth. And I walk barefoot as much as possible. So that's how I approach the grounding. I've seen grounding mats and done this and done that, but that seems to be the best grounding and the simplest, back to nature. But you got to stand on grass, not cement, right?
Thank you, doctor. Much appreciated for that. And up next we have Eileen. And Eileen, you are unmuted. Welcome.
Hello. Dr. Cousens, do you have an opinion about Ezekiel bread, which is sprouted grains, good or bad?
Well, again, it's a relative thing. I mean, it does have gluten in it. I don't use a lot of sprouted grains in the bigger picture. It's still fairly high in carbohydrate. And again, it kind of depends on your constitution as well. So I don't do a lot with Ezekiel bread. I don't think I would call it exactly raw as well.
Thanks, Dr. Cousens. Excuse me. Up next, we have Joe L. And I'm going to unmute you now. Hi, Joe.
Hi, Dr. Gabriel. Joe from Huntington. How are you?
Okay, good, Joe.
Good, good. First of all, I missed the conference live. I miss seeing you in person. This is okay, but seeing the flesh is so much better. I've put up 7 greenhouses since, and I want to comment on the vibration of growing my own food and eating it year round. And I think you're one of the few that really document that vibration. And I'm saying as an experiment on me, I'm noticing a tremendous increase in energy, vitality, and just overall well-being, eating my own food that I grow consistently throughout the year. So it does make a difference. I could tell you from my personal experience on that.
That's good. As we check the energy of food, best fresh that day. That's how we go about it. That's number one. After 3 days, when you do the Carilion photography, it significantly loses a great deal of its energy. Food that shift is pretty much has hardly any energy. We're talking energy, we're not talking calories. So Joe, I think that's the point. So you grow your own and you're gonna get it fresh. And then fresh that day is the best way to go, because you're gonna, after 3 days, it pretty much diminishes when we look at Carilion photography in the field. So I thank you for supporting that.
Thanks, Dr. Cousens. And let's go ahead. We've just got just a couple of minutes left. Up next, we have Joe W. Hi, Joe. Welcome. Hi, Joe. Joe, oh, we lost you. I'm going to unmute you one more time. Joe, are you there?
Yes, can you hear me?
We can hear you now. Thank you.
What's your question?
No, we lost her again. Joe, now we can hear you. Don't mute yourself. Go right ahead.
Okay, thank you. You said that fat doesn't make you fat. Would you recommend plant-based ketogenic diet as the best diet to follow? And can you eat too much fat? And second question, any sweeteners you could recommend, like monk fruit, stevia, which one are the best? Thank you.
In my research, stevia is the only one that doesn't raise your blood sugar.
Okay.
There are some other things that sometimes do and sometimes don't, but that stevia is the only one that consistently doesn't do that. Now, the fat issue, everybody is a different physiology. So I'm very hesitant to say you should have this much fat and this much carbohydrate. You've got to explore to get the optimum result. I measure it by push-ups and pull-ups, right? So, is my energy good all day long? I mean, these are really important clinical ways of thinking about it. That's how you tell. So I don't want to say this is the best diet of that. I mean, I'm going to say live food is the best, but the mix is significantly different depending on chromosome 19. That's what we have to get in mind. So I don't promote one diet over another. that's my kind of position on it.
Thanks very much, doctor. We have time for one more quick question. In fact, I think, nope, we lost that one. So I think we are all set, which means we're on to our next lecture. But I first want to thank you again personally and on behalf of the Real Truth About Health Conference for all you do for the conference, for all of our audience members. Thank you for everything you did today. And I just know I'm not the only one that wants to thank you. Tech team, if you go ahead and unmute our entire audience. What do you want to say to Dr. Cousens?
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. I want to bless everybody that you blossom from eating this kind of dietary approach. And I am available. People need to, you know, be seen over the internet. I can do that because I want everybody to be successful. And I want to thank the conference for doing such a great job. Thank you. Take care and blessings to everyone. May you have a wonderful coming year.